that says, from the rising of the sun to the setting, to the same place where it says, the name of the Lord is to be praised. This morning we come, for whatever reason you're here, maybe you were invited, we have a baby dedication, maybe somebody asked you to come with them so they wouldn't come alone. I want you to know that this morning the only pretext that we have is the fact that we have an appointment with the Lord. It has nothing to do with the church, has nothing to do with the name or the building, has nothing to do with you or me or anyone being here, because when we come to the bottom line, we're indifferent. There's nothing that we can do. The majority of the time, instead of being a blessing, we become more of a problem. But there is a name that is above all names. There's a name that is above all names. That name is Jesus Christ. And so this morning, if you look up here, you're going to see a brand new total group of people that is part of our worship team. And they're a result of the Friday night worship services. And I don't know what they're going to do this morning, but they've been having some good moves of God on Friday nights. And this is all, it might be a little different than what we're used to, but it doesn't have to be the same all the time. As I'm going to invite you that we're not going to ask God to be here because He already is. We're going to thank Him because He's here, and that we might be able to say, Lord, I want my life, I want my heart to be open. I want to be totally available to You. So I'm going to ask you by your hands, if you would. Father, this morning, we approach You in the name of Your Son, Jesus. We're here to glorify You. Father, there's some that came that are depressed, and there's some that are down, there's some that are despondent, and some that are confused. There's some that are not feeling well in their bodies, oh God. Father, the pressures of life seem to come from everywhere, but this morning we lay them at the foot of the cross. We humbly come, Lord, and say, here we are. Here we are. Father, I pray that every man, woman, boy, girl, young ones, old ones, middle-aged ones, everybody this morning when we walk in this room will be able to say we have been, we have seen the essence of God's presence. Father, I bind and rebuke every religious spirit. Father, I bind any and all things that are not going to glorify Your name. We bless You, Father. We magnify You. Oh God, we give You glory. We give You praise. Touch our bodies, Lord God, our minds, our thoughts. We worship You. We worship You. We honor Your presence. We honor Your name. We honor Your presence, oh God. Your name is worthy. 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 Father, at the foot of the cross, we just come and we don't hide who we are, what we've done. We couldn't even if we tried. Father, let the light of Your presence shine upon us and reveal to us all those things that need to be done away with, that in the end Your name will be glorified in us. Holy Spirit, You're welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, You're welcome in this place. We bless You. We honor You. We honor You. Just tell me for a second, just tell me, I love You, Lord. I love You, Jesus. I love You, Jesus. I love You, Jesus. I love You, Lord. This is not religion. This is relationship. I love You. I love You. I love You. I love You. I love You, Lord Jesus. I exalt You, Lord God. Oh, yes. Holy Spirit, flow through this room. Let Your name be blessed. Let Your name be exalted. Que tu nombre sea engrandecido, Señor, que tu, la gloria sea dada a tu nombre, a ti solamente. You're worthy, You're worthy, You're worthy, You're worthy of our praise. Oh, glory to God, glory to God. Father, as we start and pray that the fire of Your presence would be around us, in us, and through us. Lord God, holy care, Lord, You receive everything that is worthy in Your name. rising of the sun to the setting of the same, the name of the Lord will be praised. Can we give the Lord a hand of praise this morning? Woo! Come on, shout to the Lord with a shout of triumph is what the Word of God says. Bless the Lord. Why don't you turn around and tell somebody, maybe if you see somebody you don't recognize, you see somebody you haven't seen in a while, why don't you turn around and tell somebody, you take a couple of minutes, we're going to say, we appreciate you, we bless you. Go ahead and do that.
All right, so it's a new experience having a youth group up here. We got Chris, Israel, and Sammy. Yeah, we've been working on this for about 3 weeks, and it's just a blessing to have these young kids come up and like be able to worship God and chase after God's heart with you guys as well, and just to be up here serving God. So this song, Yes I Will, you guys have heard this one, but what this song really means to me is like how we can still serve God, like at our lowest times, when we're in our lowest valleys, we'll still stand and we still serve our God. And no matter the circumstance, no matter what happens, we're still able to stand and sing.
Thank you.
faithful now, and it's kind of like the same like category, I guess I will, but this one really talks about, like, he's in the moment, like when the guy's singing, he's talking about like his hard times he's going through. He's talking in like, okay, God, I don't see you, but I still have to believe you. I still have to have the faith to follow after you. Even when I don't see it, even when I don't believe it, I still have to know that you're moving in this place. You're still moving in my life, even though I don't see the healing yet. Even though I don't see it yet, I still know you're moving. Church, the best thing I can say is to come expecting God, to come expecting His presence, because honestly, if you just come to church, coming as a routine, I don't know, if you don't come expecting God to move, you don't come expecting God to perform a miracle in your life, you don't come expecting God to do something in your life, it's just a routine at that point. So we need to come expecting God to move, we gotta come expecting the Holy Spirit to move. Instead of running to the door, we should be running to the altar. Instead of being scared of what our husband or wife or even people around us think. We should be able to worship God freely. We should be able to stand and worship God the way we want to worship God, the way we truly want to worship. So this one, Holy Spirit, come.
I will live for the moment where I'm still in your presence. On those eyes down, Lord, speak to me now. You have all my attention. I will linger and listen. The sweetest of all, 'cause Lord, I know my I'm You are the only one.
But I don't know if you recognize the level of where we are in this worship. And this generation, or this new generation of worshipers, I believe is a generation that is going to usher in the coming of the Lord. You see, not everybody has decided to contaminate themselves with the food of the King. There's the generation that is coming up. You may be seated for a second. I'm reminded of the day that Jerry walked in my office and said, "Pastor, I believe that God has given me the call to take Albert's place." And I looked at him and I said, are you sure? He said, "I am." I didn't know if it was the right time or the right person. But it's okay, huh? As I was standing there and I was listening to these guys, they're not professional. They're a little nervous. They've never done this before here. There's an anointing that goes beyond all of the mistakes that we were able to make. You see, this is, I'm really impressed in my heart to let you know that this generation will usher in the coming of the King. His name is Jesus. And I realize that some of you are sitting here and you're wondering, what kind of a church is this? You see, this is a church made up of people of all walks of life. One time we were lost. Today we're found. We were blind, and now we can see. We had no future. We had no reason to head on with life. But one day somebody told us, there's a name above all others. That name is not Baptist, Methodist, Catholic, Presbyterian, Pentecostal, Lutheran, whatever you want to call yourself. That name is Jesus, the Son of the living God, the maker of everything made. There's another generation. I'm not saying that the other generation is old, but there's a difference in generation. There's a generation that is sitting here that you hear, she's making what we would call a lot of noise. This woman that is sitting here is glorifying God today. And she has every reason to be totally quiet and with her hands in her pockets and lamenting. For you see, tomorrow we have a service for her daughter that passed away. You see, in the midst of tears, a través de las lágrimas, a través del llanto, a través del dolor, tenemos un motivo que nos lleva hacia adelante. Sunday school is not dismissed today. Rico, thank you. Ese dolor, a veces nadie más puede sanarlo que Jesús. The only one that can solve that pain. The only one that can solve that pain. Guys, Sunday school is not dismissed this morning. There is a prophetic move in the house this morning that maybe you don't understand. The prophetic move is able to heal your heart and touch your life, mend your brokenness. As you sit down, I want you guys to go ahead and do "Oh How He Loves Us," or "Oh How He Loves." Do you know that He loves you? Maybe you feel unloved. A lo mejor te sentís como que nadie te ama. Maybe you feel like nobody cares. But I want you to know that He loves you. Regardless of what you did yesterday or last night or this morning, regardless of where you went or who you went with, He loves us. Close your eyes. Close your eyes for a second. Go ahead, guys. Are not embarrassed to raise our hands and say, "Oh, how He loves me. Oh, how He loves me. Oh, how he loves me. Come on, somebody. Oh, how he loves me. We bless you. We bless you. We bless you. We bless you. Physical state of being, about your finances, about everything. And we need to recognize this morning that God is not he's not the cause of disease and confusion, but he allows things to happen so we might be able to grow and become the people that God wants us to be. You see, every day of your life is written down in his book before anything happened in our life. This morning, nothing is haphazard. Nothing is accidental. Everything is just the way it needs to be. And if God be for us, who can be against us? If God be for us, who can be against us? Si Dios por nosotros, ¿quién contra nosotros? Oh, yes. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. You may be seated, those of you that are standing. We're going to continue with this move. We don't want to interrupt the move of the Spirit with anything that we might do that would be a cause for that, because we're desperate for God. We want God. I said we want God. We want more of God. We need more of God. Bless the Lord. We were gone for a couple of days, and this morning it's good to be home. You might travel throughout the universe if you want to, but there's no place like home. Oh, what a good God. What an awesome God. What a marvelous God. What a gracious God. I was talking a while ago about Jerry. I'm not putting him on a pedestal in any way, shape, or form. I just want for you to see the progression of what God is doing. And when God is involved in it, he knows what he's doing. I talked to him yesterday morning for the men's breakfast, and I said, "Remember, how was..." We joked around, and I said, "How was Jews last night instead of you?" And he said it was good. I said, "But were you guys Pentecostal?" He said, "Wow. We were Pentecostal." In 1986, Mother's Day, May of 1986, this church was born. Not very old in comparison to many others. But there was a word that was given that somewhere, there would be revival coming from somehow from here. And I'm not being prophetic in the sense of being prophetic, but what I'm sensing this morning as it were singing, this could be the very spark of the revival that we've been praying for. The spark that. What is revival? It is a passion for God. It's not noise. It's not a church full of people looking for a miracle. It is hearts that are changed that say, I love God more than I love myself. I want God more than I want my wife, more than I want my husband, more than I want my kids, more than I want anything. I want God. A church that has a passion for everything godly. We're in the world, but we're not of the world. We were eating supper last Sunday evening in Venice, Italy. And I was listening to a portion of the service before it froze, and I couldn't get any more. I was impressed with it, Eli's words. I came here for one reason, and that is to worship God. I came here for one reason alone, and that is to worship God. Maybe the person sitting next to me worships God a little different way. Maybe they raise their hands, or maybe they shed tears, or maybe they bow their heads, or maybe they cup their hands. It doesn't matter what we do with our bodies, but matters is what we do with our heart. What is the posture of your heart this morning? ¿Cuál es la postura de tu corazón? ¿Cómo te encontrás en frente del Dios Todopoderoso? Déjame decirte algo. We have a tendency among Hispanics to call him Diosito. There's nothing Diosito about him. He's not Diosito. He's God Almighty. He is the maker of everything made. He is everything. He's the great I am. Do you sense his presence in the house? This is not religion. This is relationship. This is experiencing the hand of a God that is a, or the God that can transform lives, change everything about us. I didn't understand exactly why God was doing what he was doing this morning. We're going to take a little parenthesis. And in this parenthesis, this is not the way we do service. And we have a baby dedication, but I have a word. We haven't even picked up our tithe and our offering. We're not going to do that yet. In the book of Ephesians, we find a scripture that I believe this morning has a meaning. Paul, speaking to the church in Ephesus. He's a prisoner. He's in prison. How many of us would be complaining if we were in prison? How many of us would be griping if we were in a hospital room? Or if we had just lost our job? Or like this mama that just lost her daughter? Clarabelle's family just went through. I had a funeral on Thursday, a funeral service on Thursday. Yes, we cry. Yes, there are tears. Yes, we feel alone at times. But when all of a sudden, when you start to feel, you start to feel sorry for yourself, all of a sudden you hear this voice that says, have I not told you that I would never leave you? I would never forsake you. I would never leave you alone. I'm with you in the good times. I'm with you in the bad times. I'm with you in your tears. I'm with you when you're laughing and you're celebrating. I'm with you when you're in the hospital and you don't know if you're going to make it or not. I'm with you in the hospital when you're standing at the bedside of your loved one that has just slipped into eternity. I'm with you in the good, the bad, and the ugly. You see, it's simple to come into church and raise our hands and sing, how great is our God. And we sing that because we're going through everything well. But then all of a sudden we're slapped with a horrible situation in our lives and we don't have the desire to sing. And we start complaining. We say, God, why me? I've been at church. I've been this and I've been that and I've been good and I've been whatever. And I've given to missions and I've given... It's not about what we give or what we don't give. It's about the fact that we're King's kids. We're a child of the King. I was sharing on Wednesday that We were boarding an airplane, a humongous monster. We were, Janine and I were sitting in the second to the last row. And the attendant, we walked in and I said, "Whoa, it's hot in here." And she said, "Oh, I'm always hot." And then she looked at me and she said, "Don't you dare and say anything about my age." I said, "I'm going to." It says it all by itself. And she said, "Are you first class?" Implying that we were sitting in the second to the last row of the of this airplane. I said, "We're first class regardless of where we sit." And you see, first class does not have anything to do with what your ticket says. It has everything to do with your attitude. Hello? Are you first class? Are you first class material? Paul is in prison. And he says he's in prison for the Lord. I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. What is the calling that you have received? There's some people that are not sitting here this morning because they've decided that the pastor, the church, the brothers and sisters, the community where they live, the place where they work, we just couldn't handle it. I've heard people through the years say, "You know what, when I didn't serve God, I used to have friends. They used to come over on weekends, and we used to have company Friday, Saturday, and half a day on Sunday. And now that we're going to church, now that we're Christians, we don't have anybody. What kind of a life is this?" And you see, when I was going through something, I used to go get my drinks, and I used to go sit with my fellow people where I was drinking, and we were family. Why do you think we have so many young people, unfortunately, in every color, yes, but unfortunately, the largest number of young people that make up a gang are Latino. Latin kids. We have a structure that is social, that is family oriented. And these young people are in church. And they come in wearing pants that are air conditioned. And they wear their pants down to here. And the girls come in dressed the way they do, and the church snubs their nose and says, "Why are you doing here looking like that?" They're looking for identity. They're looking for something. They're looking for someone. They're looking for someone to say, "I don't care what you look like, what you smell like. I don't care what anything about you. I want you to know that I love you and you're part of this family." Yes. We can recognize that if the church doesn't welcome us, the world will. If the church doesn't welcome our young people the way they look, it's not my job and it's not yours to change it. That's the Holy Spirit's job. So don't complain about what you see. What you need to do when you see something you don't like, ask the Lord to change you and to change them. The complaining issue is over. It is now time to say yes. This is something that we can do. This is something that we can do. This is something that God is doing for us. I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. I'm going to say something for those of you that are sitting here and those that are watching us through social media. There's some of you that are sitting at home or sitting here this morning, and you used to serve in church. You used to be one of the ones that used to raise your hands and worship God and magnify His name. You were part of the worship team, or you were a musician. You used to be an usher. You used to be whatever. But you're gone today. You're gone today. You feel like you don't belong because somebody in that building, in that place called church, hurt you. Because the pastor said something he shouldn't have said about you to some other people that was in confidence. I want you to know that this morning we extend a forgiving hand and an apology, and we say, "Forgive us for all of the things that we have done." But today is not the day to stay home any longer. Today it is home. It is time to come home. It's time to belong to a family and be loved by anybody that loves you as well. I'm going to tell you, there's more people that love you than those that hurt you. Did you hear me? I know what it is. I say that with a lot of conviction because I know what it is to be in a church where I was told that, "Hey, you're part of, you're like family," to be stabbed in the back. But the very same one that said you're like family. I know what it is to be eager to do whatever needs to be done, and then to be stabbed in the back and said, you know what? Well, I want you to know that if I come down, you come down with me. I'm going to tell you something. The church is not built on a man or a woman. It's not built on a person. It's built on Jesus Christ, and he will not fail us. He will never leave us. He will not forsake us. This morning, you don't have to feel like you're alone. De esta manera no te tendrás que sentir como que estás solo, como que estás abandonado. De esta manera te tendrás que sentir como que eres parte de la familia, porque sí lo eres. Look at this. Be completely humble, gentle, and patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort, listen to this, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Make every effort. Sometimes you just have to walk away. Sometimes you just need to walk away and find you a family that cares for you. Now listen, a family that cares for you is not one that's going to cater to everything you have or that you need. A family of believers is one that will see you grow and help you to become mature and help you to become a unit of love, compassion, and mercy, so that you yourself can grow and go out and become what you need to become there. There is one body and one spirit. Just as you were called to one hope when you were called. Did they give the scripture? I didn't give the scripture? I'm sorry, it's Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 4. There is one body. How many bodies is there? How many bodies is there?
One.
There's not a Catholic body and a Baptist body and a Pentecostal body and a Methodist body and a brown body and a white body. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. Look at verse 5. If you have a Bible, I want you to highlight this. There is one Lord. How many Lords?
One.
How many Lords?
One.
There's one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. How many of us? We were years ago, we don't sing that song anymore, but it used to be done in youth camps, youth services, and whatever. And it said, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. What does it mean to let it shine? The Bible says we're the light of the earth. We're the light of the world. We're the salt of the earth. But how can I be a light if I say that I'm a Christian and then I walk around with my nose in the air condemning everybody who doesn't look or smell like me? Jesus didn't do that. And then we come back to church on Monday through Friday. We go to work, and nobody knows we're a Christian. They know we're weird. They know we don't sit with anybody. They know that we don't eat with anybody because, you see, we don't want to contaminate ourselves. Shut up. But then we come on Sunday to church, and we sing this little light of mine. You even get emotional. I want to let it shine. But then we walk out of here and we put it under a bushel. That's not the way it's supposed to be. Listen, I mentioned this on Wednesday as well. We were sitting at a restaurant right next door to us, right next, where there's our table here, and right next is a young lady and a young man. A white guy from Mississippi and a Latino girl from Colombia. They prayed for their food. We prayed for hours and we started talking. And I said, y'all go to church somewhere? He says, yeah, we're Catholic. I said, all right. And we started talking. And she said, what's the difference? What's the difference? It doesn't matter if it's Catholic or Baptist or Presbyterian. I mentioned this religions already this morning. What I wanted to say is that God is not bound by a name. People are set free by a name. That name, hallelujah, that name is Jesus. Somebody ought to shout amen for that. Yeah. The name is Jesus. Yeah. This little light of mine.
Woo!
This little light of mine. I'm gonna let it shine. I'm not making fun of your voices. I'm just saying that whichever way when you do it, you blend in. One faith. One Lord. One baptism. Listen. When you go to the hospital, I don't know where they ask what religion you are. I don't know if anybody asks anymore. Do they ask? Some people put whatever they are. That doesn't make any difference. And maybe I'm stepping into territory here that I shouldn't, but have you ever noticed when you go to a funeral, especially up in the mountains, up in the small communities, there's a cemetery for the Catholics, a cemetery for the Presbyterians, and then a cemetery for the Hallelujahs. Why? Have you ever wondered? Am I the only one that... Has anybody in the house ever wondered? There's two people. John and Justin. I went to a funeral service for somebody. I didn't even know the family, but we went to this particular town, a really small town, and there was three cemeteries. One for the Catholics, one for the Presbyterians, and one for the Hallelujahs. I said, I wonder which one the Lord is coming for. In heaven, is there going to be three tables? One for the Catholics, one for the Presbyterians, and one for the Hallelujahs? Who divides God? We do. I don't want you to talk to me because I'm Catholic. And I don't go to the Catholic's home because I'm Hallelujah. Excuse me. Jesus died for the Catholics. Jesus died for the Baptists, the Presbyterians. He died for even the Hallelujahs too. Huh? So listen, there's only one faith, one Lord, and one baptism. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 5, if you have the Son, which is Jesus, you have eternal life. Amen. But then in the very same, hold on a second, let me tell you what the next part of the verse says. If you don't have the Son, which is Jesus Christ, the Old King James says you are damned. You're condemned. If I have the Son, I'm going to heaven. If I serve Jesus Christ, I'm going to heaven. If I'm redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, I'm going to heaven. If I have been washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, I'm going to heaven. If I don't serve God, I'm religious. I condemn other religions. I stand against other religions, but I don't have Jesus Christ. Listen, people, this is not victory faith teaching. This is the Word of God. We're going to go to hell. Anybody in the house agree with that? Well, there's six of us. It's not about what church I belong to. It's about whether I belong to Jesus Christ. And then we can sing, He loves me. Oh, how He loves me. And then the devil comes and he jumps on your shoulder and he says, He doesn't love you. Look what you did. You know what you did last night. You know where you went yesterday. You know how you've been doing this and you know how you've been doing that. He doesn't love you. Well, if He doesn't love me, why are you so preoccupied, Satan? if he doesn't love me, why are you so concerned? Because he knows that if we get the revelation of the fact that I've been washed in the blood of Jesus, I need to put my shoulders back and my head up and tell the devil, you know what, Satan, you can go back to hell where you belong, because I am who I am in Jesus Christ. He is my Savior, my Redeemer, my friend, my provider, my healer, my counselor, my Rose of Sharon, my Lily of the Valley, my Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is my everything, and I have nothing to worry about, because I am who I am in Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but I'm excited about who Jesus is in my life. Ben, the very first time that I had ever heard Ben sing, I had never heard that song. Yeah, so I never paid attention to it. And it was a song that came out of many years ago.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
I went to look in the Bible. I had read it before, but it never hit me. He doesn't call me a servant. He calls me friend. Have you ever had somebody important call you friend? Anybody? Anybody had anybody important call you friend? Well, you don't get out much, do you? Have you ever had anybody important call you friend? I'm asking you a question. Yeah. Have you ever had anybody important call you friend? Feel good? Joe, have you had anybody? Have you? You feel okay? You see, you didn't say it because you were a little embarrassed, but I say it because I'm embarrassed. Hey, Sam, what did you say? And you hear the next person say, I want you to know that from today on, I want you to know that you're my friend. I didn't hear you. Can you say it again? Do you want everybody to know? Well, this is not Arnold Schwarzenegger. This is not the governor, God forbid. This is not the president of the United States. This is the maker of everything in me. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the one that reaches down when everybody's kicking. You see, the Christian army is the only army that hurts its own soldiers. Because when you're down, afuera. And he reaches down and he grabs us by the hand and he says, come on. I no longer call you a servant. I call you my friend. Oh, wow. If you don't get excited about the fact that Jesus calls us friend or calls you friend, maybe that's because you're not his friend yet. Yeah? I am. Jesus is the maker of everything made before everything was or anything was. There he is. And not only that, my word says that in his book, there was a page exclusively for me with my name on it, and all of my days are written in that book. You're not a mistake. You're not a mistake. The fact that your marriage failed when it did, or it failed again and again, and it's about to fail one more time, is not the fact that you're a loser. It is a fact that you need the advice of a friend. The friend's name is Jesus. I'm sitting here and I'm hearing this guy sing. I thought to myself, wow, it hit me. The generation that will see the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ for this church. But I'm not even going to say something. Ask me some money and I'll let you.
My wife and I was praying early, in the early hours on the 17th. And I want to share what the Lord had given us, specific things to pray for. And I also believe it's for the church as well. And it says that it needs to be an urgency in the churches to deliver a message of my return, which is the return of Christ Jesus. Then he went on to say, pray for revival among the church, among this church. Pray for revival. It's coming. It's coming. And he wants us to pray. We need to pray for revival. And then he went on to say, pray for the return of the backslidden. We need to pray for those who have once served the Lord, that they will come back. And they don't need to be judged. Love them. Do good to them. Pray for the backslidden in Jesus' name.
For some of you that might not know who the backslider is, the backslider is someone that used to sit here or any other building before, and they love God. But because of a pastor, that's not a justification. There's so many people that are out on the streets today that are lost because of a pastor. I have come to a place in my life and say, God, I've pastored the same church going on 37 years. I'm sure I've hurt some people. I say, God, help me. Reveal to me who's out there, maybe because of my account. I want to go get him personally. I'm not worth you going to hell. You see, we need to love one another. We don't need to look at the door and say, oh, there they come again. I wonder how long they're going to stay this time. Let's make it impossible for them to go back into the world. Let's love them to the point where we make it impossible for them to want to go back out again. Anyone listening this morning, here in the building or in through social media, I believe that this message is for you. It's time for you to come home. It's time for you to come home. He loves you. He loves you more than you love yourself. I want you to stand with me. Would you turn up that music, please? Father, I don't exactly know what else to do. I do know that it's coming home time. The time to come home is today. Father, I don't know who might be listening live or will listen to this service later. Lord, I pray that you would speak to their lives and to their hearts. There's some that are bruised. They've become bitter over the years. When they needed the church the most. When they needed the pastors the most. When they needed compassion and understanding and acceptance and recognition and affirmation, the church threw them under the bus. Oh God, I ask you to forgive us as pastors and leaders. I ask you to forgive me for anyone that would be out lost in the cold, indifferent, a candidate for hell, because of my attitude, because of my words, or because of my actions. Lord, I want to live worthy of the calling. I want to present a message, not a victory faith, but a message of Jesus Christ. that there is one faith, one Lord, and one baptism. Lord God, this morning, I see the word homecoming loud and clear. John and Rachel just expressed it. About what you spoke to them about as they were praying. Lord God, this group of singers, this worship leaders this morning, this young ones, inexperienced, that are just starting to live. And you've showed us through them that you're no respecter of persons. You will work with those that are available. Lord God, this certainly has been a different service. But Lord God, I pray in Jesus' name. Lord God, I'm not one to do the every eye closed type thing, because I believe that surrendering, coming home, first time being saved, I believe that it is a privilege, an honor of honors, and I want the whole world to see. This morning, Lord God, I feel impressed to ask every eye to be closed. And I'd ask in this room, if you feel like this is your homecoming time, would you just quickly slip your hand up and put it down? Anybody? There's one. Thank you. There's two. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? This morning, you don't need to respond to me. Respond to the Holy Spirit. Anybody else? Holy Spirit of God, you're in the house. You're in the house. You're in the house. Father, I pray for those in the room and those that are listening, but they're saying, they're admitting, today is homecoming day. Wrap them around your arms of love and compassion. Love them. Bless them. Lord God, I pray that to this morning, the young and the old, the men and women, would all respond to the call of the Holy Spirit that says, I'm coming soon. I'm coming soon. Lord God, let the church hear what the Spirit says. We magnify you. Oh God, there is an awesome, solemn presence, a calming, soothing presence. Holy Spirit of God, wash us. Wash us. Wash us from all unrighteousness. That your name be blessed. That your name be praised. Father, I thank you by faith for those that are listening that have said, I'm coming home. And for those that raised their hands in the room, it's coming home time. We bless you. We honor you. We bless you. In Jesus' name. And everyone in the house said, yes. And everyone in the house shouted, yes. You may be seated. Bless God. You guys have a song? We're going to pick up our tithe and our offering. I'm sorry? Oh, he loves us. The same one he did a while ago? Okay, fine. Because he loves us so much, we're going to pick up our offering and our tithe. This is only for the church people. Those of you that are visiting with us, you don't have to worry about this. Right after this, we have a baby dedication, so we're going to be prepared for that as well. All right? Praise God. Go ahead.
God loves us when we were at our worst, when he saw us in our sin, when he's seen us in our worst, He still looks at us and says, I love you, my child. I still want you. I still want your heart. And we put a lot of things before God sometimes. We put work, we put many different things before God. But yet, He's still there, and He still loves us. And we're still blessed to have that opportunity to sing about God's love and how much, like, He loves us. So sing as well.
He's jealous to me, but His love's like a hurricane out in the street, bending beneath the weight of His wings and mercy. Going all on a sudden, I am unaware of His afflictions eclipsed by glory. How beautiful you are, and I see the reflections of me. And oh, how He loves us so. Oh, how He loves us. How He loves us.
Faithful, wholehearted, bold and brave. And so this morning as you come, we believe in not in our tradition, but in scripture, Jesus was taken to the temple twice. He was taken one when he was 8 days old and one when he was 40 days old. Then when he was 40 years old. But when his parents, when Joseph and Mary took him to the temple, the prophets and the prophetess were there, and the prophet said, "My eyes have seen the deliverance of Israel." And this morning we pray that Caleb will live up to his name and be totally devoted to God. But you see, guys, he can't be devoted to anything unless you train him. He'll be devoted to what you guys are. And there's nothing wrong with being devoted to a whole lot of things, but God has to be number one. Without Jesus being number one in his life and in your lives first, there's no way that as he goes to Sunday school and he goes to the nursery or however old he is, that one day he'll come home and say, "You know what? You know what, Naomi, I'm sorry. Go ahead, come on up." Okay, I forgot what you told me. Anyway, we have the idea of the fact that one day he can come where you're sitting watching TV or you're eating supper or whatever, and he says, "You know what? I asked Jesus into my heart." Wow. But see, he can't invite Jesus into his heart if you don't give him the opportunity. Now, I remember a few years ago, I'm not going to ask you how old you are, but I remember a few years ago that you were in the same situation, and I held you in arms, and I said the same thing to your mama. And today you're here because she's not been a perfect mom, but I believe that through the turmoils of life, there was an indention in your spirit that said Jesus is the ultimate answer. And so today you're here to present your son to the Lord. You know, you're the hero. You're supposed to be the hero. He's going to want to be like you. And when he's out there playing with other kids, he's going to tell other kids, "My daddy's bigger than your daddy. My daddy's better than your daddy." And he's a kid. That's all they know. They're kids, innocents. But one day he'll be able to say, "You know what? I'm making a choice and a decision today because my hero led me this way to know that Jesus is my ultimate response." I love your car. I think you'd be a great associate pastor. Because everything I say, he goes, "Yeah, he got this car." Yeah, I invite guys here. You guys have been invited. And I want you to know that this guy right here, this good looking kid, he's my buddy. He's been my buddy since he was that age. Because I did the same thing with him, but he's my buddy now. And he's sitting here because he wants to be like me. You guys have been invited because they trust you. Now, I'm assuming you're related to him. He has friends? Us. He's a good friend. And I think you related to her. I think so too. But what they've done with you is that more than just a tradition, you've been given the opportunity to walk into their bubble when it comes to this kid. God forbid that anything tragic was to happen to them. But by you coming here in front, first of all, in front of God, in front of the congregation, what they're saying is that if anything was to ever happen to us, we trust you enough with our kid. I know right now you're in a transition in your own life, and by transition I'm talking about what God is doing. And let me just interject in there that I think one of the most beautiful things that you did the other day was that you had this kid and this young lady with Justin for the world to see, as in your home, Jesus is number one. We need more of that today. That was awesome. The fact that he just came not too long ago. The fact that you're able and not afraid to have the whole world know that in your home, Jesus is number one, is amazing. And so I know that they're able to say, we know what we're doing. And so this morning, do you both commit to making Jesus Lord of your life before we can do anything with him? If that is so, say we do. Do you commit to showing him, and I hope you're doing that already, but do you commit to continue to show him that the only escape, the only shelter, the only protection that he has besides you guys is God? Yes, you do. Do you commit to stand with them to bring this child in the ways of the Lord? To be able to say, he needs God. He needs to be where God is. If so, answer, we do. Does this congregation commit to helping this couple with this child, to bring him up in the ways of the Lord until the Lord comes? If so, say, we do. All right, stand with me. Now he's an important one in this picture. This is Caleb, Elijah. No, don't Kenny. You can talk into it, but don't. Say hi. Say hi. He's just looking and approving. Caleb, Elijah, Chavez. Would you reach your hands out together as we pray? Father, I take in my hands this beautiful child, a gift, a precious, delicate, tender gift that you have bestowed to this home. Lord God, in your word, it says that every good gift comes from the Father of lights. This morning I hold him in my arms, excited because I felt a prompting in my spirit that this generation will see the coming of the Lord. Lord, I pray that this child, if he grows past the age of accountability before you come, that he would be able to say, I have some good news. I've made Jesus Lord of my life. And I believe that he will be taught that Jesus is our only Savior, that he's our healer, our baptizer in the Holy Spirit, and our soon, very, very soon coming King. For our message is simple yet complex. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that these parents with this witness has come today to dedicate Caleb, devoted to God, to be dedicated to God. Lord God, lay your hand of protection over him. Lay your hand of healing over him. Father, protect him from calamities and tragedies. Allow him, Lord, to be taken care of by you because his parents have opened their doors to you in their home, where you can stand with your hand over him and protect him even from childhood diseases. Take care of him. Bless him. Guard him. Oh, Lord God, we bless you this morning for the gift, this gift. And this morning, Lord God, as a minister of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, I lift him up to you in dedication. We thank you. We bless you. We honor you. Bless them as well. Bless the witnesses. Bless the grandparents. Bless everyone involved in their lives. Oh God, bless them. Because of him, bless them. Father, we thank you. We sense your presence in the house.
We will be very careful, oh God, that you receive the glory, that you receive the honor, that you receive the praise and the worship. That you, oh God, are given glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen, amen and amen. Give him a hand. Just a second, please. Please remain where you're at until we finish with this, because we have something else that's very important that we want you to know. Go ahead and go. We will give you something else to write what we need. Go ahead, would you please? And Naomi, where are you? Right after. Thank you.
that it?
Okay.
We have one more announcement, but my announcement is that this one is about Sunday school. But right before we dismiss, right after we dismiss, I'd like to see the youth leadership, all of the youth leadership here in the church. Please, stay behind.
Good morning, everyone. I just wanted to say come up here and give an announcement really quick on behalf of the Sunday School Ministry. We are going to do a back to school supply drive, and we want to go ahead and try and fund all of our Sunday school students with supplies. As you know, as parents, it's a lot sometimes on the list, and so we thought it would be nice to give back to you guys and see if we could get some volunteers, some people to donate some supplies. So that way we can give it away to our Sunday school kids. We have about, we estimated, we're gonna try and sponsor 100 students this year. On a good day out in the back, we have about 12, 16, 20 students. If everyone ever, like if all the kids showed up on one Sunday and they all went back there, we would have close to 100 kids, and that's including the youth group age. So we're really proud to have a big number of kids going back there, and they love Sunday school. So we wanted to do also, leading up after the school supply drive, we're going to be collecting supplies as soon as possible until August 7th. August 7th is the Sunday before we do an event that we want to do a back to school bash for the kids. So I have flyers that I'm going to pass out after church. But after the school supply drive, we're gonna, all the ministry, Sunday school ministry is gonna gather all the supplies. We're gonna put together some nice fun bags for the kids to go back to school. We're gonna have a back to school bash with prayer. We're gonna have food, drinks, games, water activities, and then we're gonna give away our supplies. So please donate to our Sunday school ministry. Donate the supplies. I have the supply list, and then I also have the information for the actual back to school bash. And I hope that all the families can participate. We want parents to be involved, kids to be involved. We want this to be a time to fellowship with the parents, a time to fellowship for the kids to fellowship. Because we have a lot of kids going back there, but they're not really friends. They just kind of go back there and they hang out. But I want them to become more of a family back there. I want the kids to get to know each other a lot more. So I think this event will do that, and thank you so much if you donate in advance. We will have boxes out in the foyer starting next Sunday, you guys can drop off your donations there. So if you guys have any questions, just let me know, or anybody in my Sunday school ministry.
I want to appreciate Naomi for the awesome work she's doing with Sunday school. And I appreciate her because she's been so good to us. I mean, can you just feel the presence of the Lord in the house this morning? Have you felt the presence of the Lord in the house this morning? Yes, Lord, I want you to stand with me. We started off with a strange, not strange, but a different type of service that we normally do on Sundays, and we're going to end it a little different because we don't usually end it this way. But I want for us to lift our voices and say, Our Father,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and forever. And everyone said, Amen. Amen. God bless you. Go out and have an awesome week. And you be blessed. This evening, our Spanish service is at 4. We invite you to come and be with us this evening at 4, and then the rest of the week. The same schedule as every week.